We're here today with Dr. Amelia Malagamba. She is a Southwest Borderlands Scholar, Assistant Professor, School of Art, Catherine K. Hertzberger Institute of Arts at Arizona State University. Thank you, Amelia, for giving us this interview. It really is an honor.
My pleasure.
Today's date is July 28th, 2010. We're here at the University of Notre Dame. Maya, I want to ask you, I'm going to ask you some questions about your background and your education and then your career, and then, of course, about your the focus of your research on contemporary Latino arts and culture, especially borderland studies that you do. And then I hope you'll say some things about Mexican photography, because
okay.
I know you're passionate about that. I've heard some stories.
Oh. Yeah. I hope they are good ones.
Yes. Yeah. Before we start, could you state your full name and date of birth for our cataloging purposes?
Of course. Amelia Malagamba Anzotegui. I was born the 10th of May of 1950.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And I guess that's where we'll start. My first question is to ask you about growing up, your home life, your experiences as a young person.
Okay, probably something that will reflect my experience for the rest of my life has to do with the decision of my father of where I was going to be born.
Oh.
Because at the time, my parents were living in Ensenada, Baja California, a border town, an hour from the border, an hour from Tijuana. And in 1950, there were no regional hospitals that could take care of my mom. My mother got pregnant 9 times, and she lost 5 kids.
Mm.
And so every time that she was going to give birth, she would get really seriously sick. My father was a medical doctor from the military, and so the only options that he had at the time were either to send my mom to deliver me in the U.S. side of the border, or to send my mom with me inside to Mexico City, to the military hospital in Mexico City. And so my mother had to make the trip in a Second World War II airplane from Ensenada to Mexico City, and I was born there.
She was alone?
She had family in Mexico City, mm-hmm. and so they were taking care of her. But she almost died when she gave mm-hmm. birth to me, so it was a good decision by my father. People ask why he didn't choose for me to be born in the U.S., and my father, being the son of the Mexican Revolution, really loved the idea of having everybody being Mexicanos.
Mm-hmm.
So especially in a town which was a border town. In those days, of course, most of the Mexican border towns were more related and interconnected with the U.S. side of towns and economics than with the rest of Mexico. When the border was pretty much isolated from the rest of Mexican life. And so for him it was very important to have all of his children to be born in Mexico.
And when did he move and your mother come to the U.S.? Or were they?
They never came to the U.S.
They were here?
They lived in Ensenada from my father was sent by the military to that post in 1947, 48. My mother arrived in early 1950, I believe. I'm not sure exactly when. And from then on, they lived there until they died.
Mm-hmm.
And their ashes were, my mother said that she wanted her ashes to be part of nature. Mm-hmm. And so we dropped them in a very special place in the ocean, where she loved the desert landscape and the Pacific Ocean.
Mm-hmm.
Both my parents are there mm-hmm. still today.
Mm-hmm.
So we were always border people.
Mm-hmm.
I came to the U.S. when I was 16 years old. I came to San Francisco. I had finished my preparatoria, which is in Mexico you have grammar school, high school, and then preparatoria. Excuse me. And from there you go to do your BA. And I wanted to go into the art field. Since very early in my life I knew that I wanted to do that. And so they sent me to San Francisco. And I was pretty young to start college. And I arrived there right in the moment that things were...
Oh, yeah, what year?
I arrived there late 1966, and I was there for 1967. Mm-hmm. I always tell my students I was there for the summer of love.
And you see, and you're here today. In one piece. And
in one piece. So I experienced the civil rights demands on the U.S. side, the women's feminist movement. When Martin Luther King was killed, I was there. Mm. I participated in several happenings to organize and mobilize people to raise money for scholarships mm-hmm. for African-American kids. I visited the Mission District where things were taking shape with the beginning of what later will become the Galería de la Raza. Mm-hmm. So I was very lucky in terms of my experience in the United States at that time. And then I went back to Mexico, and I went to La Escuela Nacional de Artes Plásticas, San Carlos, from the Universidad Autónoma de México. Mm-hmm. And I arrived there in 1969. So I spent 1967 and 1968 in San Francisco and then moved to Mexico City. And for the first time in my life, I was shocked. Of course, by then, the killing of students of the events of 1968 had taken place in Mexico, and of course, all over the world, youth was making their claims of citizenship, both politically and culturally. Mm-hmm. And I was shocked because not only the situation, the political situation for youth was really difficult in Mexico at the time, but also because the people at San Carlos were for the first time questioning me in terms of who I was. That was the first revelation that I had that I was different. They were telling me that I wasn't, that I couldn't be Mexicana, that I had to be something else. And I couldn't understand why they were saying that, because in my home and in my experiences, the lens through which I saw everything had to do a lot with my self-definition as a member of Mexico as a country.
Is it because of your growing up on the border
and, yes.
and that association yes. with the U.S.?
Yes. And so for the first time, I began to feel that there was something different in terms of the geographies mm-hmm. And the rhythm of experiences between different peoples in Mexico. So it was a truly revelatory moment, if you will. Mm-hmm. And then from there, I did studies in sculpture, because my BA was in, not in studying the arts, but doing the arts.
Also a fine arts versus
fine arts
art
versus
history.
Art history. Mm-hmm. So I went to Nuevo León, and I spent 1 year there in a free workshop on sculpture, and then I moved to San Miguel de Allende, Guanajuato, where I finished my BA. By the time I was already married, and I already had my daughter, the only daughter that I have, Ángeles. And I was given an award, which it is, I was very surprised. I think that women in Mexico, we are not accustomed, or we were not accustomed to be recognized and be mm-hmm. seen. And I got a national award for the best student in the arts.
Mm-hmm.
So by CONACYT and other institutions, so I was very surprised, but my parents were very proud.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a time that I was beginning to moving to becoming a divorced woman.
Mm.
So it came then, and then I got divorced, and I began teaching.
Studio arts?
And well, it was something that we call environmental design, which had to do with the use of space and the connections with community, building community. And I was teaching this class in an experimental program at the time. It's not experimental anymore, of course, after so many years, called el Colegio de Ciencias y Humanidades. And I was also from UNAM, and I was working on this school that was in a place that was a forgotten, if you will, place. It was a regular settlements outside of Mexico City, slums, called Netzahualcoyotl. So I was teaching there. It was an incredible experience teaching there. And then I was also teaching later on at La Universidad Iberoamericana, and there I was teaching silk screen printing to so many students that is not even funny. And then I was invited to work at el Colegio de la, de, al Colegio de México, which is a think tank working with this researcher that was doing border studies, Jorge Bustamante.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
And that was 1978. And so I was teaching at the Ibero, and I was working. I was teaching art, and I was doing research, something that really I hadn't done before. But I had all this knowledge, and based on my experience living at the border and with communities in the U.S. side. And then I was invited to work at the excavations of Templo Mayor as the residence artist. So I left La Ibero, and I went to work at Templo Mayor. And that was, I was so lucky. That was.
What kinds of work did you, were you
You know, archaeologists are always
drawing.
Yeah. Archaeologists are always fighting, saying that whatever they discover is their pieces. And so this is my offering. This, you know, we call it ofrendas, the places where the ancient Mexicanos put the gifts to the gods. And so sometimes when they were digging, they will find these ofrendas. And they will say, this is my site, this is my ofrenda. But as an artist, I owned every single piece, because at the end of the day, after restoration and conservation, they will send them to me, and I will draw each one of the pieces.
That would have been heavenly.
Heavenly. And I would touch them, smell them, look at them, every single line and orifice and everything. So I stayed there for 2 years, and I produced a very impressive amount of drawings, which, by the way, today, one of those archaeologists that started their careers there published together with his findings in Templo Mayor in one book in Mexico. I haven't seen the book.
Oh,
but
I'd love to have a copy for here.
My drawings.
Yeah.
And then it's at this time that El Colegio de México and the Border Studies Program within El Colegio were looking at creating another colegio. But this colegio to be just addressing border issues. And so they invited me to come and participate in this effort. And I left Mexico City to come to engage in this new adventure of my life in 1980.
Is that the north?
North, el Colegio de la Frontera Norte, which at the time was called Centro de Estudios Fronterizos del Norte de México. I was probably one of the first ones to arrive from the team that was in Mexico City. I am a co-founder of el colegio. I stayed there for 11 years, and I became the first director of the first Department of Cultural Studies in Mexico, believe it or not.
Wonderful.
I didn't know this. 2 years ago, 1 year, I don't remember. They were celebrating the 25th anniversary of El Colegio, and they wanted to recognize the founders, the co-founders. And so they invited me, and I went, and they told me, you are the first, you are in the history of Mexico as the first director of the first Department of Cultural Studies. And I said, really? I didn't know that.
That's really wonderful.
And during my tenure in El Colegio, my main research, my main interest was to build connections between the art scene in the Chicano community on the U.S. side and the art scene on the Fronterizo community on the Mexican side. For me, it was incomprehensible that the artists on the Mexican side were doing art that really didn't connect with their own space and their own reality and their own place where they were living.
What was it? Was it more
At the time
European
they were
or
well,
South
they were trying. They were trying to figure
Mexican?
Out who they were. I think they were many of them were doing landscape painting, really 1940s landscaping. Mm-hmm. It's like time had a stop there. At the time, of course, there were no schools of art, no very few, if any, spaces for exhibitions. There were no support for the art community, just one or two efforts mm-hmm. that people in my view, were heroic, just trying to keep this activity going for so many years. And so we started to construct projects that had to do with bringing Chicano artists and Mexicano artists working together in workshops, so both of them could learn from each other mm-hmm. and have an interaction mm-hmm. and discuss. So this I did for 11 years, and then the other thing that I did that I am very proud of, I must say, although it was very painful, was the first 3 years of this event that we entitled Encuentro de Mujeres. And this women encounters were around literature, women writers, and scholars who were studying the writings of women.
Across
borders. Across borders. Mm-hmm. And this is the first time ever, mm-hmm. ever. So I did a lot of things that were never done before because nobody was paying attention. Nobody was really mm-hmm. concerned about these things. And I did that in collaboration with wonderful women from UCLA, Aralia González, Sara Pott, Beatriz Mariscal. And then later on we brought in PIEM, which is the program for interdisciplinary women's studies at the Colegio de Mexico, that was directed by Elena Urrutia. So she came on board on the project. And so we organized these three conferences that brought women from all over. But it was very painful because it made clear for many of us, both Chicanas and many Fronteriza women, that the view from Mexico City towards the border and across the border was one view that was very elitist, very ignorant, very charged with issues pertaining to race, class, and even amongst women that were many of them calling themselves feminists, I would say very patriarchal in their attitudes. Mm-hmm. And so it was really painful.
But a beginning, perhaps, to address
the issue. 3 years.
No?
The 3 years were, I have stories to tell that one day I will make public, but it was painful. It was really, really, really painful, physically, emotionally. And I had to, organize and find the monies to
just coming up against barriers and
barriers and attitudes and scholarly work, arrogance and ignorance, and it was really painful. By the way, some of the artwork produced by these workshops that I organized together with Karen Bocalero from Self Help Graphics, Chican Indian, Arizona, El Taller de Malaquias Montoya, Sam Coronado Studios later on when he became a mm-hmm. studio, and many other studios. I also began working with Gilberto Cárdenas. Mm-hmm. We were creating these spaces.
And when was that? Was this in
this the started early on in 1984, 1985. Mm-hmm. And
so he had his gallery at that time, I think?
He already had his gallery. And I did this he helped me bridge mm-hmm. and do the collaborative projects together with the Chicano community. I looked for the artists, I invited the Mexican artists, mm-hmm. and some of the work produced in these workshops that were distributed equally among the artists and the different institutions participating, I sold. And with the money of those works of art being sold, I was able to support the women in cultures. So art mm-hmm. was supporting art. Mm-hmm. And I found that really beautiful. Mm-hmm. But it was really a lot of work and very painful.
Mm-hmm. A lot of administrative work.
Yeah,
and organizing
also too.
And
in a way, it was really, you know, also that those events revealed to me very clearly that there are two centers of power, Washington and Mexico City. And then culturally speaking, there are other centers of power in the U.S., but Mexico City at the time was the center. And so there was this, what we call ombliguista, you know, coming from the, your, what is it?
Your gut? Like a
no, the
your navel? Your
yeah, mm-hmm. the navel. At the center of the world, mm-hmm. where life begins and life ends. And the border was looked at by these many of these women that came as irrelevant.
As
they
irrelevant?
Were trying to yeah. They didn't respect the work of the Chicanas. Not all of them. I generalizations are not good, but many of them did. And Chicanas were astonished to see the reaction of these women, Mexican ladies from Mexico City, mm-hmm. and. It came a point where I thought and I felt that especially the Chicanas, and I think that for me that was a revelation that I felt much closer to the Chicanas in terms of my own experience than the women of Mexico City, even though I had lived in Mexico City and I had worked in Mexico City, because the Mexico City women were looking at us who were the facilitators of this encounter, the women in the border, as irrelevant and maybe a little bit some of the attitudes are like we were the servants. So it was a total revelation for me to understand in my own skin the tremendous gaps and the difficulties really in place for really being encounters. Really creating a space where an encounter could be possible. Nevertheless, these 3 years were astonishingly productive because many connections were done outside the events. And for many of us, clarify, in Mexico City, at the Mexican side of the border, and on the Chicana side, a lot of things mm-hmm. that were in many instances conducive to find other ways to understand
mm-hmm.
the phenomenon.
And that's where the idea of it becoming a beginning came, or was jumped into my
yeah.
mind, is that once you lay out, okay, here's what we're dealing with, and now we can go forward.
Yes. Births, as you know,
yeah.
you're a mom, are always painful.
yes.
So it was a painful birth. But I must say that at the time, later on, 1985, 1986, 1987, also the Border Arts Workshop with David Avalos, Patricio Chavez, Guillermo Gomez Peña, Emily Hicks, And Maria Araña from the Mexican side and other people from were working also in the art field of looking at the border as this relevant place. And I think that the efforts, the collective efforts taking place in the 1980s from both sides of the border, from the different groups working, really brought about later in the 1980s, I mean late 1990s, beginning of the 2000s, this renaissance, I wouldn't even call it renaissance. It wasn't, because there was really not much there in terms of body of work. In terms of experience, it was. But in terms of body of work on the Mexican side, there was very little. And then in the late 1990s, this whole explosion of creativity and amazing art production.
From both sides.
The U.S. side was already there, mm-hmm. long before, mm-hmm. from the 1960s, the Chicano movement, Chicano art movement.
Right.
They were there, and they were the first ones to really begin addressing border issues. But on the Mexican side, mm-hmm. that was not happening. And so it is all these steps that took place from different organizations, and I was lucky to be there and participate with my own personal efforts and institutional efforts. As a Colegio de la Frontera Norte, to be part of that will help create the conditions under which this other thing came about on the Mexican side.
Mm-hmm.
So it is, and the connections today between the artists working on the Mexican side and the artists working on the U.S. side, Chicanos, Mexicanos, it is there, and it is amazing, and it's so beautiful to see. So it has been a long path, and I continue working on the same issues. I continue to work on my researches on border art, looking at all these things and how the place, geographically speaking, has so much to give, not only to the artists who grew up there, but as is happening today with other events that have become very important in the mainstream art world, how is this place visualized, conceived, theorized, and what are the problems and what are the difficulties for the insiders looking in, the outsiders looking in, and then the combination of things, of these currents, meeting, encountering, mm-hmm. conflictuating the situation. So it is, right now, it is just a fascinating place, mm-hmm. to study and to look at. So, and I'm working on that right now. I'm trying to to come up with a...
I want to ask you what you're working on right now, but before that, maybe this is a good point to ask you to talk a little bit about exhibition, and maybe starting with the title, and which I loved, it makes you think for a bit.
Well, with my association, as I explained from so long ago with Gilberto in working on the production of the arts on the Latino, Chicano, Mexicano communities on both sides of the border. I have worked with his collection, and as you know, it's one of the biggest collections in the country, from very early on. Probably with the first work that I did on his collection was the curatorial work on an exhibition that I put together for the Centro Cultural Tijuana, when it was very recently inaugurated in Tijuana, 1987, I think, on the work of Malaquias Montoya.
Mm-hmm.
I came to, Gilberto was living in Austin, and I wanted to do an exhibition that would reflect the connection between the work that artists from the Mexican Renaissance, what we know of the Mexican Renaissance, los muralistas, and all of the artists working after the Mexican Revolution from the 1920s to the 1940s, that heritage, that part of our history, and there it's the connection with the Chicano art development. Mm-hmm. And so I came to see Gilberto's collection at the time, which was not as big as it is today, but I spent a week going through what he had, and I was very impressed looking at the work of Malaquias Montoya. And so I said, I think I can put together a very good exhibition that will reflect my interest as a curator in looking at these connections, and also in concentrating on one particular artist and how he's looking at the overall concerns and issues from his own perspective. So I put together an exhibition of around 80 pieces called Del Arte Revolucionario al Arte Chicano, mm-hmm. the work of Malaquias Montoya. And it was very well received. Was probably one of the very few individual exhibitions of Chicano art in Mexico at the time. Very few. Mm-hmm. And it was very well received, and I was very pleased with that. And so when I began to think about an exhibition, looking at the border artists and going back in time and looking at what was there, I said, well, how is it that the artists look at migration? Because I have looked at the border in terms of the artists, in terms of ancient healing practices, healers. I have seen, I have looked into the spaces of the domestic female realm. I have looked in the Latin Chicano production. I have looked in different areas, but I never thought about looking at how do they see the phenomenon of migration. And so talking with Gilberto one day, we were start talking, and he said, you know, I've been thinking about this too. And so we began thinking maybe I can do an exhibition on this. And then I said, well, it would be very expensive to do an exhibition like we usually do, inviting artists, or me going to the studios and look. That would be very expensive. But an exhibition looking at, you have collected. So maybe if I can just look at what you have, mm-hmm. that will make the project feasible in terms of economic expense. You have the work, I don't have to buy the work, I don't have to travel, I don't have to ask for. Mm-hmm. And so I wrote the proposal to get monies for the exhibition. And I look at his whole collection. This is in 19. I don't know. What was
he was here? Already here?
Yeah, he was here.
This was just in 2000.
2000.
Something.
So I began looking at it in 1997, probably. Mm-hmm. 1997. Looking at the works and writing proposals and going and talking to people. It was such an amazing work of research and exploration and discovery, because first of all, in terms of exhibitions dealing with the issue of migration, like with many other things, they were very few, mm-hmm. historically. The one that was best known was the one organized by Doug Massey and Duran with their collection of retablos. And they did an exhibition of retablos. These are vernacular forms of, I like to call them thank you notes, mm-hmm. from the Catholics, thanking the saints and God for the miracles given. And these two guys, these two scholars, have an amazing collection of retablos specifically addressing the act of migrating, mm-hmm. by these people. But there was nothing more, not seriously looked into. And so I was very encouraged to go and explore that theme. And so I did. And I put together this exhibition. One of the things you asked me about the title that I was thinking about, that, you know, there are many ways of, the title needs to reflect what is the exhibition all about. And my intention was to really not only reveal the way that the artists were looking at migration, but from that, understanding what are the main issues. Mm-hmm. And so...
And the humanity.
And the humanity of it all.
That's what came across to me.
Yes, because usually we tend to talk about numbers.
Yeah, numbers and.
And this is a very human based look into the phenomenon. And many of these artists, by the way, they are migrants themselves, so they were not only talking about a concept, but they were talking about their own experience, mm-hmm. or their family's experience. And I said talking, but they were talking with painting. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so how to, you know, something that had been discussed for so long, that has been studied for so long, but not really in terms of the arts present, if you will, as a one particular issue. And so in Mexico, my mother, who loved to use dichos, these proverbs, popular sayings. She used to say that this dicho, when she was referring to somebody who people were judging, mm-hmm. and she would say, no, caras vemos, corazones no sabemos. Faces we see, faces seen, hearts unknown. And I thought, you know, we talk so much about this. And really, what the art is bringing us is the hearts of these people. Mm-hmm. We look and we don't really look. And I think that not only the using a dicho reflects what the artists are revealing, the hearts, but it's also another layer there that connects the art itself with how these artists have been inspired, which many of these artists were and are trained in very good schools. But it is a conscious decision that they make to connect themselves in their art with the vernacular of their own culture. And mm-hmm. so by using dicho, I was also mm-hmm. underlining that connection between mm-hmm. the art, the artist, and the community. Mm-hmm.
So. Wonderful. And the show, it was here at the Snite. It went to other places in the Midwest, Milwaukee?
It went
right?
to Milwaukee, to the university. I'm so bad. It will come to me. To the Fuller Museum in L.A., to the Alameda Museum in San Antonio. And it has, the university is a Catholic university in Milwaukee. What is the name?
Oh, yes.
It starts with an L. It has the name of somebody. Oh, my God, I'm so bad.
I know, I should know it, too.
What is the name? You don't remember, Brett?
No, Brett. Basketball. I'm thinking basketball, too.
Well, anyway. And... one thing that and this is just a small tale, that sometimes we don't really understand the impact. But I was proposing this exhibition to the Arizona State University Museum, and I was talking to the director, and I think that they were afraid. And now you can understand with all the things that are happening today. So they decided that politically it was too charged for them. But she said, and talking to her, she said, you know, we have had a very good audience coming to the museum. And I said, really? I said, how many? And I said, well, last year we had overall, and through the year, we had, I think she said, from 45 to 50,000 people coming. And I said, is that the whole year? And she said, yeah. And she was very proud. And of course, you know that Tempe, Phoenix, is a conurbated city. Mm-hmm. It's like 7 or 8 or I don't know how many cities mm-hmm. in the same urban space. So we are talking about, I don't know, 5 million people. How many people does South Bend has? I don't know, 200,000? Let's say 300,000.
Much smaller.
Okay. And I said, well, this is very surprising because the numbers of the museum, the Snide Museum, coming to see this exhibition, which was there on show for 2 months and a half, maybe less than that, they had close to 40,000 people coming. Mm-hmm. And I bring this to your attention, Tracy, because this is a history that repeats itself, which is very disturbing. Many museums, the argument is that there's no interest in looking at the work of many of our own community artists. And the truth of the matter is that this situation of showing and then having all these people coming presents itself everywhere, with the Cheech Marin exhibitions, with the Cara exhibitions, with big and small exhibitions. You have a public that might not go to the museum, this white elephant, mm-hmm. Very often. But when they, because they are never represented, they don't see right. themselves there. But when there are exhibitions of Latino Chicano art, Mexican art, people come. Mm-hmm. And they come. I mean,
they bring the family.
They bring, and yep. it become. And one of the things that I was very surprised and very pleased is that I wanted to have comments by the viewers of the exhibition. And one of the things that I thought it would happen was that we would have, like in other exhibitions that I have seen, the comments, nasty comments, because migration is a hot topic. Well, I think we have like 2 or 3 out of, I don't know how many hundreds of comments. So I think that the art, again, with this exhibition demonstrated that there's a way of bringing people together, looking at things from a perspective that you might have never seen before.
That you don't that's have access to.
And that's what art does.
If you don't know yes. someone who's a migrant, you don't have access to that. But through the art, yeah. you can.
So it was a beautiful, beautiful yeah. experience. I know that the exhibition inspired some poets, mm-hmm. Some of them not even Latinos, which mm-hmm. I am so happy for mm-hmm. that, because this exhibition was not only for Latinos, was for everybody. Mm-hmm. And I think that people saw that. And also, it is really interesting because my daughter has this person that she has a relationship with professionally. And when the exhibition came to San Antonio, my daughter lives there, he told her, this is one of the first exhibitions that has moved me to the core. Mm-hmm. And she looked at him and said, you know what? My mother was the curator. He said, no. And he said, yes. No, I don't believe. You know? So these are things that echo and continue to come to me, which I really appreciate, because art was put to work in at many levels, from the aesthetic perspective, from the research perspective, from the humanistic perspective, from the heart perspective, from the museographic perspective. Mm-hmm. So I was very pleased with this effort.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. Again, it keeps on going.
Yes.
Is it scheduled to?
Not anymore. Not mm-hmm. anymore.
But and I love the teaching resources.
The teaching resources, that is the labor of love,
yeah.
of Jackie Welch and the other person that I can, I'm sorry, in the educational department put together. And I collaborated with them as an advisor. And so I was very happy to have that out there. Because a lot of kids had the experience and were able to talk about their own experience. The reports that Jackie gave me about children talking and engaging in these conversations as children, understanding what impact the art had in terms of their own lives and family lives was just beautiful, and how they share with other children that don't have the experience. So it was really nice. You know, when I think about an exhibition, I think of it as it's like producing a book. The thing is that a book, of course, it has a very long life. But maybe, you know, if you're lucky, the edition is 3,000. And so 3,000 buyers, 3,000 readers. And then, you know, libraries, and then, but not many people go and look for this kind of book. An exhibition, one place, 40,000 people, children, all of it, people of all ages, going to other places, looked at by 20,000 others, and then at the book. And so the immediate impact is, of course, much bigger than the book in terms of viewing and accessing different publics. And of course, the book will, I am not saying that the book doesn't have a value, of course. That's my business. but certainly this is another way of making research, making art, and making people come together.
I want to ask you, I guess, one of my last questions. What are you working on now so hard here at Notre Dame in seclusion with your door closed? And
I'm trying.
What does the future hold, I guess?
My future. I'm trying to finish a book on border art. I'm working with Caroline, the editor, which I really love to work with. She's wonderful.
Yes.
And I must say that the support of the Institute for Latin Studies to me, in terms of my work and in other areas of my life, your kindness, all of you, including you, Britt, your accessibility, your warmth.
That's because you cook so well.
Thank you,
coming.
No, I haven't cooked for any of you yet. But I think that, you know, they coming to a place where people are working towards a clear mission of believing in a project of creating a space and opportunity and research for an area, for multiple areas, many of them being neglected for so long, like the arts. It is a blessing. It is a blessing. Every time that I come, I am in awe.
Oh, that's wonderful to hear.
And I know that when you are in a one place, sometimes you don't appreciate in the full extent what is it that you have. But when you have a point of comparison like I do, I have to say that my tenure here, when I come, is just full of blessings and inspiring, I have to say this, for me, research, and I might go against the grain, especially with the demographers and the statisticians, but I think the research has, in my view, has to have emotion. And I am nourished here in my emotional intellect every time that I go. So I love to be here, and after that I have to leave.
I know. Well, we love to support you while you're here. That's You inject, you know, emotion and enthusiasm back to us as well.
Thank
it's
you.
Wonderful.
I love to be here. I do. You are all terrific people.
Thank you.
So there's the book and that's it. What I'm doing here, I think, is enough.
Anything we haven't talked about that you think we should mention?
Well, I think that one of the things that I knew that it was happening, but I was able to see in this time here with you guys is the construction of the library.
Oh.
And I have to say, I don't know, for me as a scholar, maybe for other people this is not as incredible, but for me as a scholar, knowing so many libraries in the materials that they house, this is an awesome, incredible place.
We are very lucky.
You have original materials, first source materials that very few people have. The collections that you are putting accessible to the public are just... I wish I could come here and just stay in the library like for a year.
Well, we need to work on that.
But it is just amazing. And I hope that you can also, and this is just it's coming, you told me about photography, but I do hope that you can build up a film archive.
Film.
Of photographs and film. I hope so.
I know of one wonderful collection right now that I'd love to have.
Because, you know...
That you're working with.
Yes. Well, a little bit.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, but certainly in many ways, I would say that this library, at many levels, is, if not unique, very, very special.
Very we have special. The seeds planted, and I think that with the support from the university and this new space, now we're really ready to go forward.
Yes, and I think that the more the work that you have done in the collections that you house are known, the more scholars are going to have to come and visit this place because there are materials here that very few people have. Mm-hmm. So I'm so happy. I was just jumping up and down when I saw the space available. And I know that it's a collective effort, but I think that the generosity of Gilberto Cárdenas and your incredible discipline and know-how as an archivist have made this possible.
Thank you. Well,
so, and I know that there are a lot of things going on, but probably that was in terms of this trip the most astonishing thing that I had. This place.
Well, it will be here for you to come and sit in these comfy chairs or here at the tables and dig into the collection. I have things I want to show you.
Yeah,
when you have time.
When I have time. this was just
get your book done. And
I know.
Come back.
I have to finish. Yes. I'm working, but these are processes that, God, they are painful and they take so long.
Yeah, I know.
But you know, it is. I think that when this book comes to light, hopefully pretty soon, the support of the Institute, it is out there as the most critical support of my work.
Well, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.